Hello and welcome back to Bee Minute, the Hive's only minute-by-minute podcast dedicated to B-movie. I am one of your hosts, Barry B. Benson. My sweater is Ralph Lauren and I have no pants.
And buzz, buzz, that's the sound of the bees. Oh, it's me, it's the co-host again, Niall McGowan. Here was another load of pollen jokes. I tell that joke all the time. Never gets old. Never gets old.
Every single episode, man.
Absolutely. Classic. Slays him every time.
And we are joined by our very, very special guests. Would you like to introduce yourselves, you wonderful duo?
I am Richard.
And I am Ashley.
And you may know their voices from previous episodes of our old show, Bat Minute.
Yeah, yes, of course.
And this is Bee Minute. Minute 49.
Is it up to 49 already?
Yeah. So, I mean, 49, I know you as a fan of the show, Rikky, it's like this flying pie. It feels like me and John have been doing this show for like 5 years now. Like, it's just...
Oh, crazy.
Such a slow moving movie, B-movie. But
yeah, it's a long film. You know, it's an epic.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of those, it's up there with your Citizen Kanes and whatnot. But this minute starts with a goddamn bear and it ends with Ray Liotta. You heard that right, people.
Yeah, the Emmy award winning for his guest stint in an episode of ER in 2005, Ray Liotta.
I love the way that's what he's known for.
Hey, was anyone a fan of ER? Did anyone used to watch ER back in the day?
No, I just know ER is like that thing that was like, oh, Channel 4 in the evening. And I don't even think my parents watched it. Like, I think it's a thing you would assume they would watch, but they're like, no, not even they were swept up in ER mania.
Nobody really bothered with ER, did they? Until Ray Liotta was on it, did his guest spot.
and then
it was suddenly big news for a week.
For a week.
Yeah. No, so I remember my mum used to watch ER, but then I got into it because Phantom Menace had just come out. And I just after doing Phantom Menace, Ewan McGregor was in
Oh my
ER.
God, really?
In a two-part episode. Yeah, Ewan McGregor is holding up a convenience store and I think it's George Clooney, because he was in there obviously, was like held up in there as a hostage. But obviously Ewan McGregor wasn't an out-and-out baddie. It was always more complicated than that in ER.
Oh, of course, yes. I'm sure he had some very... It's America. He probably needed to do the crime to pay for his health treatments.
Yes, there's a lot of that.
Yeah, and it had a very British name.
I think because every time Rikky said... Maybe it's because of the Scouse accent. Every time he said ER, it sounded like you were giving someone like a cup of tea or something. Like, ER. Like, it just...
Ash just subtly made that very same joke.
Oh, my God. No, I never watched ER. I think we're the wrong age, Niall. I think we were too young to get into a boring show like that. And nobody we knew did either because, I don't know, maybe you had to be like a woman in your 20s? I don't know.
I would say it was like the dawning of the golden age of television. Big budget, series long plot lines, things being shot on cinema film. As opposed to on video.
Yeah, getting in Ewan McGregor and George Clooney and Ray Liotta. I mean, Jesus Christ, you couldn't get bigger than that.
Well, indeed. I much prefer that end of this minute, the Ray Liotta end of the minute, as opposed to the opening with the special witness who is brought in growling.
With the continuation of the, from what we talked about in the last episode, the Build-A-Bear joke.
Yeah.
So they call it Build-A-Bear, like, oh, like this. And a giant bear comes crashing into the courtroom.
Now, I have a problem with this because every single time I see a grizzly, I actually get double vision. And it's just a cross eye after bear. I literally made that up as a joke.
That is a very Jerry Seinfeld joke. He would appreciate that.
Yes. Have you seen this? Have you heard about this?
What's the deal with crosses?
I like the bear thing. Like, so yeah, we're back in the courthouse as the prosecution is underway. And Barry brings in this bear, and he's using it to make a point. But it's an odd point, because his whole thing sort of revolves around, like, how would you like this thing smashing up your place, huh? Bees need more respect.
Well, that's the thing, too, because this movie, as me and John have mentioned before, like, the movie's, it's got a very anti-bear, you know, vibe to it. Like, it's pro-bee, anti-bear. Like, even later on, not to get into spoiler territories, but they shoot Winnie the Pooh at one
that's
point.
That's a
in
genius
film.
Bit. I can't wait to get to that one.
One thing I'm still always curious about, like, yeah, so they're very anti-bear. At no point in B-movie do they ever address wasps. You think that would be, like, because you think the wasp would be the natural enemy of the bee, because the wasp doesn't contribute to honey, honey manufacturing or consumption or anything. The wasp also has a stinger, but it doesn't kill it. So the wasp is like, oh, bee, but it's even more of an asshole, because it's like, oh, it can sting you as many times as it wants. It's totally fine.
I think they do reference that once or twice that we've seen so far. They mention wasps, but they're not their arch nemesis.
You think they should be having like a wasp joke of like, oh, there's the wasps, and then it cuts to like a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant family.
Especially scenes as they've lean into a lot of the stereotypical Jewish jokes in terms of the Jewish family and everything. You think that's just waiting there? That's
totally
a gold mine.
Because basically, as we've said already, the bees, they are Jewish. That seems to be the whole joke. Like they're bee-ish. Is what?
Yes.
As we've heard.
Although they do mention, because they had the bee-ish line, and then later on, Barry B. Benson says to be Larry King, like, oh, the human Larry King's exactly like you, like the braces, glasses, very Jewish. And it's like, so Jewish is a thing in bee culture, as is bee-ish.
I suppose it has parallels in Spaceballs, where they have Druidia.
Oh.
And it's all funny. She doesn't look Jewish.
Yeah.
And that's, yeah, so they're the Jewish parallel in the Spaceballs.
See, I completely forgot about that, because this may be controversial. I don't like Spaceballs.
Spaceballs either. Like, I never. It's one of those things. Like, I think people seem to hold it in high reverence. And I was like, even when I was a kid, it's like, this is pretty bad. Like, yeah.
It seems like it was made by someone just trying to get on the Star Wars thing who'd never really watched it. Like, I don't know, just make some jokes.
Oh yeah, definitely. It was literally my favorite film as a kid. I remember one day when I watched it four times in one day, was how much I liked Spaceballs. But it was like, I probably enjoyed it in the same way that I liked Rise of Skywalker, in that I wasn't quite able to follow what was going on in terms of the plot or who was doing what or why, but there was spaceships and coloured lights in it and like different space sets and things like that. And that was all I was interested in. I never really saw it as a comedy or being funny in any way. It was just another thing I could watch, that spaceships.
Hey, I won't hold it against you. I once watched The Phantom Menace three times in a day. I was like 11. So, you know.
Was that the same day Rikky watched ER three times in a day? That same day,
exactly.
I heard as well.
Exactly.
But, yeah. I do have to ask as well because they had the continuation of the Build-A-Bear joke. Do you have any connections with Build-A-Bear yourself? Because I at one point went for a job interview at the Build-A-Bear workshop. And let me tell you, I wasn't a fan of their policies.
Really? Oh, the gossip here. Come on.
Beef with their interview technique, because it's one of those things like, well, Build-A-Bear is like, oh, there's loads of kids around and stuff, so you have to be good with the kids, basically. And what they made you do for the interview, you come in, like, one point you had to make your own bear, which is, you know, that's fair enough, just want to see how creative you are and whatnot. And I remember at one point they made all the interviewees march around, and there was customers in there and stuff watching you march around with a guy at the front as a band leader shouting like, we're going to build a bear and all this other stuff. God. And then he had a whole song. You had to sing along with him and stuff. And they just had someone sitting watching you just to see like how much could you pretend that you didn't want to die while you were doing this? Because if you could fake it enough, then you got the job.
That's crazy.
Oh, God. It's, I hate all that kind of American style staff induction.
Yeah, faux enthusiasm
that they do in place.
Yeah, yeah.
Although I can't say as a father of two young girls, I can tell you that Ashley actually has a hilarious anecdote about Build-A-Bear.
Oh.
I do. I have never set foot in a build. It's hilarious. I've never... Never been inside a Build-A-Bear.
So what they do...
Despite everything that that you've heard.
No, I'm being facetious. I've been to Build-A-Bear many times. It's a very good concept. What you do is you go in and you choose the bear's skin from various vats of bear skin, loose floppy bear skin. And then you pick the one that you want. And then you pick an outfit for it. And this is how they get you. The bear itself is actually quite cheap.
Ah, it's the other stuff.
It's the DLC for the bear. Yeah. That's how they
the
get
horse
you.
Horse armor.
And then you go around and you get all the extra bits. Like, my daughter's really into Spider-Man, so we got the Spider-Man costume, and it's a Spider-Man costume. There's only a bit of fabric. And that's how they get you on the price. And then what you do is you then, when you go right the way round, there is a colossal vat in the center of the... in the center of the Build-A-Bear workshop that's like connected to a suction tube. It's not a suction tube, it's a blowy tube. Mm. And you take your floppy bear skin up to it and they kind of put it over. I'm picturing it, they definitely blow it into the back, because if you blew it into pretty much any other part of the bear, it would be really, really bleak. But what you do is you fill the bear with its soul, with its essence.
Oh my God. It's a bit like the Dark Crystal, but in reverse.
Yeah. Bit of Dark Crystal. I'm getting into Warhammer again. And there's also a bit of that with Drakari. They steal souls, the Dark Eldar. And there's very much a Dark Eldar influence on Build-A-Bear Workshop. And then you get a little heart, and before they stitch it up, you kiss the heart, and then you make a wish on the heart, and then you push the heart into the guts of the bear, and then they stitch it up in front of you. And then you've got to take it home for what is a very long, and they don't tell you about this, a very long post-operation recovery period for the bear itself. There's a lot of heavy medication, immunosuppressants and that type of thing. You can't just bang any old heart in there and then walk out the door.
And you have to buy the meds from them.
Exactly. And then that's when they jack up the price as well. If you get the generic ones, it's pennies for a pill. But if you get it through the insurance, they jack it up to, you know, literally hundreds of percent.
Has there ever been a situation in your house where like the bear has rejected the heart? And it's come like bursting out of its chest, kind of thing. Or
yeah, the bear was very unenthusiastic about the autopsy that we had to do. Its heart wasn't really in it.
I will say though, like, you think the B movie could have capitalized on this mention, because like they could have had Build-A-Bee. They could have had a tie-in with Build-A-Bear. Oh. But then at the same time, it's like, well, what can you really do with bees? Because it's like, they're all going to be yellow and black stripes and stuff.
Yeah, I bet there probably was.
And then, as we've mentioned in this movie, all the characters either have buzz cut haircuts or beehive hairdos.
Ah, yes.
So there's not much variation in terms of what you can do. Maybe that was like the downfall, but it's like, well, we are pretty uniform in the presentation of the bees.
Plus, it's DreamWorks. DreamWorks is completely distinct from Disney as well, isn't it? Sorry if this has been, this obviously been mentioned in an earlier episode. But DreamWorks is distinct from Disney. Did it start off as part of Disney?
I think it was made, was it Jeffrey Katzenberg and Spielberg? I think Katzenberg left Disney to start DreamWorks. So right. I think it's DreamWorks is like a middle finger to Disney, essentially.
Indeed, indeed. But anything like that, there is a Build-A-Bear thing for anything Disney. Doesn't matter whether it's really boring or basic, they'll do it. I actually used to work in the Disney store when I was 19 years old. And Ash actually has a very interesting anecdote about that.
One time I did set foot in the Disney store, and I believe Richard was working there at the time. And I had the misfortune to eat a Buzz Lightyear plush figurine, which I didn't get into trouble just because Richard was there looking out for me and being a nice guy, being very understanding about it.
No,
but also you're talking about this is a shining a light on the corruption within the Disney store, because they you do cover ups in the back.
Well, exactly. It's a double standard. Like if a child had done it, the child would have been sent down for years, possibly been hung by the neck until death. But you know, one rule for them and one rule for mates' rates.
Should you be divulging this secret information?
Absolutely not. Please strike it from the record.
I do have to ask though, like Rikky, as you were a Disney store employee, did they have any like bullplop induction for you where you had to go around with Mickey Mouse ears shouting about like singing, I don't know, A Whole New World or anything like that before they employed you?
Oh heavens, yes. They definitely did. So for a start, I wasn't an employee. I was a cast member.
Oh.
And so the shirt that I had
cast with an E.
Cast of the E. That's Disney. No. A cast member. And it wasn't called the shop floor. It was called the stage.
Oh, come on.
Backstage and on stage. They split everyone up. At the time, Lilo and Stitch had come out, and it was like the Lilo group and the Stitch group, and Jungle Book 2 came out, so there was like a Bagheera group and stuff like that. And it was like targets to try and meet your target. But I was like a stoner 19-year-old loser who was not worthy of employment for at least another 4 years of my life.
Isn't that every Disney staff member?
Well, some of them were actually very enthusiastic. So none of us came close to ever meeting any of our targets. But the best days there, a lot of the time I'd be a greeter and they had these colossal baskets and you had to put the baskets into every customer's hand and find out what it was they were buying and who it was they were buying for. And the reason you'd shove the colossal baskets in their hand is because we were told that... If somebody went in just to buy one thing, they'd go in, take it off the shelf, take it to the counter. But if they went in to buy one thing and that one thing was sat in the bottom of a colossal basket, psychologically, it gives them that extra nudge to want to fill the basket. And so people would buy more. So my manager would come up to me and if there were customers in who didn't have a basket, I could get in trouble. And if I didn't know they would say, what does that customer want and who are they buying it for? And if I didn't know, I'd get in trouble then. Oh. But it was all worth it for the occasional shift where I got to test out the toys.
Oh.
And there was one time when they brought out the Toy Story bubble guns. And you occasionally see bubble guns down the market, these light, flimsy plastic contraptions that fall apart within moments. But Disney know how to make a bubble gun. The bubble gun mixture was a separate bubble gun mixture. And if you use regular bubble gun mixture, it would actually break the bubble gun. You had to buy the special bubble gun mixture.
Oh, right. Okay.
But boy, did it work. And it wouldn't seep out this occasional bubble and then spit a load of froth. You would get a concentrated jet of bubbles coming out of it. And there was one day coming out of the Disney store as it was. Do you remember where the enormous statue of a horse made of rope with rope testicles and a man standing at the back? That, if you're not from Liverpool, that was a thing that happened for a bit. But the Disney store used to be by that statue, and it's kind of it's not officially a square, but it's where a few different bits of pedestrianized areas meet up in Liverpool city centre. It's quite an open space where Church Street meets Bold Street. And it was in the middle of summer, it would have been approximately the summer of 2002, 2003. And I had two Buzz Lightyear bubble guns, and I stood outside the store and fired these bubble guns and the temperature in Liverpool was just the right amount, so it lifted the bubbles, but not too fast, just gently lifted them into the air. And within a minute or two, I had filled this whole open air space from like the bottom, from like the ground floor to like the top of 5-story buildings was like this tornado of, but it wasn't, it was a gentle tornado of concentrated bubbles. And genuinely, I'm going to take that memory to my grave. It was one of the most treasured memories of my life. People were just walking through Liverpool city centre going, who is this wizard? What is happening here? We're just going about our business, and look, we've been transported into this magical wonderland. And it was because of me. It was because of my actions that I'd dropped a moment of genuine beauty into the lives of hundreds of people.
You made the dream reality.
I really did. Just remote that. Like, that was an actual thing. I should put that on my CV.
Yeah. Who says Disney can't lead to magic? You know.
Yeah. Indeed. I really like the bear, though, because the bear bursts into the courtroom and is growling and swiping at people and being scary. But then when Jerry Seinfeld says, okay, we're done with that now, the bear is quite clearly in character and breaks character and just like, all right, I'm done now. And then turns around and like saunters out of the courtroom.
That was the bit that I genuinely laughed at.
This is kind of weird, though, because, again, the movie's so anti-bear. It seems like this bear's doing Jerry Seinfeld a favor here. Like, he's kind of like, oh, yeah, no, I was here to do this little thing. And it's like, okay, we're done. All right, I'll see you. You know, it's
he's paying him. You know, he's giving him a wage. He turns up, he does his shtick, he goes.
Yeah, so.
Even the bear keeper seems to be in on it as well. The one who's got the bear on the chain.
Yeah, he's getting a bit of the money.
Mm.
There's a bit of a rancor keeper vibe going on between those two. What would have been perfect would have been just as they're stepping out the door suddenly slams on the bear and kills the bear.
And the keeper should have been dressed as Malakili.
Malakili? Malabili.
Oh! Perfect.
And then, of course, we have Judge Bumbleton sort of shaking her head disapprovingly. Of course, it's this character voiced by Oprah Winfrey.
That blew my mind when I read that on the research.
I did not know that was the case.
And they actually, because Oprah wanted to be in the movie as much as possibly could, even though they have, like, you know, this was all just animated with, you know, normal, like, Toy Story-ish, like, you know, CGI animation, Oprah actually came in and put on the motion capture suit and sat in a judge's quarters and shook her head just for that one shot. Like, not the not for the rest of the performance, just that one shot.
Well, it's interesting you bring up the motion capture, though, because let me just say, right, I've brought this up multiple times, but you see it a lot in this scene, especially with the characters who are coming up. Is it just me, or is the animation in this, like, great? Like, I think not only does this hold up well, it looks better than most of these movies now.
I think, considering this is like 13 years old, it's like, this is fine animation, you know?
It looks better. Most of these CGI pieces of crap they bring out now that they call cartoons look worse than this.
I submit for your consideration, Enter the Spider-Verse.
You're picking like a masterpiece there, though. Come on.
I was fortunate enough that I got to watch Into the Spider-Verse the other day because, as mentioned, my two-year-old daughter's really into Spider-Man. And having never been able to sit down properly and watch a proper film properly with my five-year-old, my two-year-old was so bang into Enter the Spider-Verse, you would not believe. To the point where the only time she got up was to go out and get her Spider-Man backpack from by the front door and carry it up to the couch and then sit there on the couch holding her Spider-Man backpack as we watched Into the Spider-Verse.
Yeah, she got good taste. That was a pretty damn good movie. So
it was fantastic.
That's one of those ones you could tell in, like, as it was coming in, you see the trailers like, ooh, that looks good. And then when you actually watch it, it's like, yeah, that was really, that delivered on every level I wanted it to deliver on.
Surprisingly, yes, it did not disappoint.
I could not fathom why everyone was saying it was a good film beforehand. I was just like, but it's not really Spider-Man, and it's someone else, and it all looks a bit weird, and it's like, I don't know how you get. But like, as soon as it was like, the opening scene was out the way, and it grabs you with its very stylized animation as well as its use of color, and the simple but very well delivered characterization, I was like, oh yes, this is definitely worthy of all the praise it gets.
Yeah, I was exactly the same, especially as someone who up until that point had never been hugely into Spider-Man.
No, me neither.
So I didn't know these characters. I didn't know his name. I knew Miles Morales was a thing, though. So I'm like, okay, so yeah, this is another Spider-Man and things. That's literally all I knew. And I loved that movie so much, I then subscribed to the comic afterwards.
Is there an Enter the Spider-Verse comic to accompany the film?
No,
just the generic, you know, amazing Spider-Man.
Standard, yeah.
And it turns out it's amazing.
Not false advertising with the Amazing Spider-Man, apparently.
No!
I will say, though, I noticed, because you're talking, like, oh, they made obviously something as good as Into the Spider-Verse over on that end, because you can do that kind of thing. I know that the guy who was supposed to do the music for B-movie, Michael Giacchino, who, of course, you know, he did music for Rogue One, things like that. To end up turning down B-movie, but apparently he's been brought in to do the music on that new Batman movie that they're doing, and it's guys, you know, I'm assuming they have to keep making them because they can't get it right. Because they, like, oh, yeah, we made that one Batman movie. It was terrible way back in the day. And they keep trying to make them. And it's like, dude, if the character is that bad, did you have to keep making new movies and stuff? just give up. Give up the ghost. It's clearly not working as a character. Like, just abandon this whole Batman damn idealistic fool crusade thing, you know? It's just...
Wrong show.
Wrong show.
But speaking of music... We have a new witness on the stand here.
Oh my god! And it's amazing.
We have Barry's given a Sting, a grilling, the popular music artist Sting.
He's giving him a grilling for using the name Sting.
Yes.
To advance his career whilst not actually being a beat.
Yeah.
Yes.
And there's two prongs to this. And one of them has just struck me.
Oh, I think I know where you're going with it then. Go ahead, yeah.
So is this is leaning towards cultural appropriation. Yes. If they don't out and out say cultural appropriation. Do you think that was, because the whole time I was thinking, I haven't listened to the Police for a while.
Oh.
Are the Police good? Are the Police bad? I definitely used to enjoy them.
They're all right.
But one thing you can't deny is that... there is an element of cultural appropriation to the Police.
Yeah, they were the white reggae, basically.
Well, it's literally their album is literally called Regatta de Blanc.
Yeah.
Oh, of course.
And he does do the accent.
He does, but when he's not doing...
especially in the early material.
Mm. Yeah.
Now, and this is something... So obviously Sting has... he does a lot of... he does reggae voices. He does an out-and-out American accent a lot of the time. So there's a lot of reggae rhythms to it. And it's something that I've experienced personally myself, because are any of you familiar with the cartoon Rasta Mouse?
Oh yes. Yeah.
Rasta Mouse, Scratchy, Zuma, also known as the Easy Crew. I have this come up quite a lot in terms of cultural appropriation, because thankfully, you know, opinions are shifting on it and people are starting to, it's starting to be a more mainstream concept in terms of taking the cultural capital of peoples that you don't belong to. But I'm a big fan of watching Rasta Mouse with my daughters, and it has a great running theme throughout it of forgiveness. In every episode, somebody does something wrong that is quickly identified, the person is instantly forgiven, and they work together to make a bad thing good. And they do that every single episode, and I love watching the cartoons with my daughters to the point where I bought some Rasta Mouse books. Hey. And now I am finding myself in a very difficult position because I'm having to read these books to the kids.
And you don't want to have to do the voice, I guess.
I don't, and I feel really bad doing it. And the kids, and this is the good thing, generationally, the kids are more switched on than the adults are. And even at a young age, my kids are listening to me reading those books, and they know that there's something not quite right about
like,
it.
Dad, don't do that.
And I'll be reading the books, and they're like, Dad, there aren't even any Chinese people in Rasta Mouse.
But I will say, though, like, I actually do genuinely think, like, that's what they're getting. Because the whole theme of this, like, you know, there's multiple themes going out throughout B-movie. And they even have, you know, things about the environment and the plight of the bees and whatnot.
Yeah.
I do think cultural appropriation is what they're going for here. Because they even have little things, of, like, when he's arguing with Renee Zellweger. And she's like, oh, but it's organic. And he's like, yeah, but it's our organic and stuff. And his whole thing is like, well, you're just stealing from us to profit for yourselves, basically. And it is incredibly appropriate. That, yes, Sting, of all people, the guy who's been, to this day, I remember, like, a year or two back, he released an album with Shaggy. And I remember in interviews they were still talking about, like, so you've been lambasted with cultural appropriation charges since pretty much your entire career, and he's just like, yes, for the love of God. And I think I'm more curious as to whether Sting knew that was part of the movie, he just thought, oh, it's a joke because I'm called Sting. And then they animate him, because he's rolling his eyes and he just seems like he's just so sick of being there and stuff, it makes him out to be a real prick, for one thing.
Well, I mean, That's Sting, isn't
he's
it?
He's doing yet another accent as well. Like he seems to be doing a sort of a Hugh Grant kind of home counties thing when he didn't, wasn't he like, didn't he have a strong Geordie accent
at
one point?
Yeah, he was a Geordie, wasn't he?
Did you ever see the musical that he did with, what's his face, Crocodile Shoes?
Jimmy Nail?
Yeah, oh my him and God, Jimmy Nail really? What?
Do like a, yeah, it's about like the closing of the docks in Newcastle or whatever, and they both go, you know, full Geordie on it with a big orchestra and... I watched about 10 seconds of it, got confused and watched something
else. We'll do a minute-by-minute podcast of it after this.
It needs...
That's amazing. I didn't know that at all.
I don't think they're... I think, knowing what we know about Jerry Seinfeld's frustration with what he perceives to be a readiness to be offended in audiences nowadays, I don't think they are having a subtle... cultural appropriation theme to acknowledge that cultural appropriation is a phenomenon. I think they're taking the piss out of it. And it's a isn't this a ridiculous argument to be making? I think that's the direction they're taking.
Oh no, I hope not. I really hope not.
I mean, so we'd have to stop doing the show, John. Oh. If it's being deliberately offensive about
this.
Well,
we are appropriating this from the bees. I mean, a bee should probably be hosting this.
That is true. That is true. Yeah. I mean, we tried. We asked a couple of bees, but then we just got stung. But I guess it was our fault for going into their territory, really.
We got stung. Very good. Yeah.
It has actually always made me laugh, though. Like, how, you know, Sting gets mocked for this. But other people get away with it. And I was thinking, what's the difference? Because I like a lot of like two-tone bands, you know, Scar. And they never really took any flack for it. Is that because that they both, like, they included black members in the group and they also took the music and made it their own new thing? Whereas the Police were just like, we're white guys doing reggae.
You have got to have at least one... black person.
Somehow that makes it okay to people.
Together, even if everybody else and the lead singer who's using the accent isn't Jamaican, as long as you've got one person with dreadlocks in, that gives you the authenticity you need to go under the radar.
Well, that was my thinking. Initially, I was like, well, if you're not doing the voice, is that what's okay? But then you look at like Bad Manners and Buster Blood Vessel. It's like, he kind of does the voice though.
Yeah.
What's the chap from UB40? He's the prime example of it. But he's got black mates, so he's all right.
So he's let off with it. Yeah, that's the thing.
There's a black guy in it. That's how you do it.
That's how you do it.
Now we can make a reggae band. Sting. Who are we talking about? Sting.
Well, with his name, right, I always thought it was because, like, he was a punk, which he was for a while, allegedly.
No, that's not the reason, though, is it?
I found out that the name came about because he was famous for wearing a yellow and black stripy jumper.
Yes,
which is true.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Yeah.
Apparently, he used to play with a band called the Phoenix Jazz Men.
Well, that's
I thought they would bring back the classic line from earlier in this movie of, you like jazz? Like, they could have brought that up in the scene, but they didn't. But yeah, apparently the... because, you know, Sting's name is Gordon Matthew Sumner. Apparently, yeah, the band leader Gordon Solomon nicknamed him Sting. And I was like, well, too many Gordons in the group? Was he just going, oh, I can't have this guy appropriating my name of Gordon. I'm going to give him his own name. So it's like, hey, he wore a stripy jumper one time. Hey, you're like a wasp, Sting. It's perfect. Good.
Well, I always thought, though, because he was involved in the punk scene for a while, and people were very famous then for wearing stripy mohair jumpers, sweaters to our American listeners. So I thought it was from that period he was wearing like a Vivian Westwood mohair thing. No, it was just a jazz thing.
Yeah, the jazz, they were good. Yeah.
I was very upset about that.
Was that what it was?
He was in the Sex Pistols movie, which is awful. I don't want to call it the Sex Pistols movie. It's a piece of crap Malcolm McLaren movie. The Great Rock and Roll Swindle, and he is briefly in it with his band and what they called the Fabulous Blow Waves, and they try and sexually assault the drummer Paul Cook, which is played for laughs.
Oh dear!
I know Malcolm McLaren trying to be controversial. What do you expect? Johnny Rotten had long since departed this nonsense. He's like, I am not having anything to do with this.
But saying like, oh, Sting's involved the punk scene, I always associate him more with the mods, and I think it's entirely because, like the other things that Sting has appeared in. Mm. Of course, his big, sort of big acting, it wasn't his debut, because his first role was in a thing called Radio On.
Yeah.
But then the second movie was, of course, Quadrophenia, which with Phil Daniels and Phil Davis.
Well, weird connection. Everything's connected, as we say here on B-Minute.
Of course.
But, Johnny Rotten, John Lydon, was originally considered for the lead of Quadrophenia, and he said no. Of course he said no.
Maybe it's because he's like, well, that guy Sting's band tried to sexually assault my ex-drummer. But other things he said, Sting, if you go on his IMDb, he's got like 109 acting credits. Most of them are for music videos, and I consider that cheating, because that's like, playing you, and like, that doesn't count. But, he's been in a couple of very kind of like, you know, oh, that's quite notable. He was in something called Brimstone and Treacle, the Dennis Potter thing. Dennis Potter, obviously, very acclaimed writer. Yeah, Dune, of course, he played, Thaid Rutha. I'm never too sure the pronunciation on that.
Hey, I am here to defend that movie as well. I genuinely love it, both as a sci-fi movie and as myself a fan of David Lynch. I don't think David should be ashamed of that film.
No. Did anyone think that that was a nod at the start of Rise of Skywalker? You know, when they make they're making a series of atmosphere to atmosphere jumps in the Millennium Falcon at light speed, and they go from planet to planet to planet, and it kind of feels like it's a quick montage farewell to the Millennium Falcon.
Yes.
Not that it does actually serve as that. But one of the atmospheres they jump into, there is a giant slug that jumps out, and everyone says, oh, it's like the space slug from Empire Strikes Back. But the first thing I thought was that's a nod to Dune, because Dune was said to have been an inspiration for George Lucas.
Mm. Yeah, no, I 100% think that's what it is. Because, I mean, it's an inspiration even down to the fact that Han Solo smuggles spice.
Spice, yeah.
I think I was thinking later on, because when they go through in the quicksand, underneath the sand, they're in these tunnels, and it's essentially a sandworm that's down there. Mm. And I was like, yeah, that's Dune. Like, I think you're...
No, that one is actually a nod to Tremors. Kevin Bacon was a great inspiration to George Lucas back in the day.
Yeah, they're very, very connected, those two. Mm.
I have to say, though, I was a bit disappointed because, you know, they're obviously remaking Dune now. It's like, oh,
it's called Dunk now.
No, Dunk, of course, yeah, Dunkachino. That's of course me and John's other podcast, Jack and Jill Minute. We talked about Dunkachino. Apparently they've not officially announced who's playing the Sting part, with Sting and the metal nappy, of course, been the most famous part of
just get Sting back, he looks the same.
It could do, actually. But I think the rumor is it's going to be Ty Sheridan, who's like the kid from Ready Player One. I feel you have to maintain the precedent that David Lynch has set and get some random pop star. It should be like Ed Sheeran playing that part, or someone.
Oh,
or like Katy Perry coming in to do, like, oh yeah, she's that guy. And
I was going
to
say, gender flip it. Why not?
Ed Sheeran was once a judge at a battle rap tournament I took part in.
Oh my.
Years ago. We went down to the Don't Flop doubles tournament in London. And I didn't know who he was, but I don't think anyone knew who he was back then, because that's why he was judging a rap battle contest in a pub in London. And it was literally as he was doing the judging, after me and my rap partner made an absolutely dreadful show of ourselves, and I'm thoroughly ashamed of our performance for it. But whilst Ed Sheeran was giving his reasons for why the other guys won, there was just a guy smoking crack in the background.
Perfectly normal thing to be doing.
Very exciting times. It was very exciting times.
But the most important thing is that Ed Sheeran didn't pick you. So, Ed, we're calling you out.
Do you feel, Rikky, if you had won that and then been skyrocketed to superstardom, had you been offered by Denis Villeneuve Sting's role from Dune? Would you have donned the metal nappy yourself to take that part, do you think? Or
because I've not seen Dune and I don't know the context, all I'm hearing is, would you don the metal nappy? And that's a context-free sentence, effectively.
You've not seen Dune?
No, I've not seen Dune.
It's a very Richard film.
Downloaded the super-duper-duper-duper-duper extended version when I went through a phase of trying to watch all the classic films I'd never seen. And it has like a drawn introduction where it's drawings of the history of the universe of Dune, and it literally lasted about 20 minutes and there was no live action content in it at all. It was narration and a series of drawn stills showing different planets and things like that and the origin of the spice, and I got 20 minutes in and wept. And
I just watched the theatrical release, and if you like that, then watch them.
I think so, because although David Lynch disowns it, it's at least it's a film. You can watch it. Unlike whatever that was.
I would recommend going and watching the documentary, like Hodorowski's Dune, about Alejandro Hodorowski's abandoned Dune film that he's going to make. He's got all the concept art out. It's influenced. It was a major influence on Star Wars because it was the concept art was just handed around in Hollywood because it was an abandoned project. But people were like, holy crap, this looks amazing. And so things are swiped left and right from it. And then just do that and then just go and read Dune. And then you're like, oh, yeah, that's a better experience than watching any cut of the movie, really.
I'm very much on the audiobook train at the moment, so maybe that might be one to audiobook.
Oh, I have the audiobook and I've never put it on because it was it like 8 hours?
Oh, it'd be great if they had David Lynch in reading the audiobook of Dune. Like, chapter one. If the spice was out in space and the sting came in and he had, oh, he had this nappy. It was made of metal. Like, David, you have to read what's on the page.
The Kwisatz Haderach.
Don't just make up your own version of Dune. It's like, why not? I did it back in the 80s and everybody hated it.
Now all we need is David Lynch in B-movie.
Oh, man. That would
why
be
not?
Something.
I mean, he turned up in Louis. Oh, we're not allowed to talk about Louis anymore, sorry.
No, that's the thing, because he was in... apparently, he was offered the role of the lead villain in Gravity Falls. There's a villain called Bill Cipher, who's just a talking triangle with a top hat. Great show, Gravity Falls. I highly recommend it for people. But apparently, David Lynch flat out turned them down. But so the actual voice is just the creator of the show doing a David Lynch impression. What? So he just kind of comes out and talks like this the whole time, and you're just like... Yeah, that's. I can't imagine David Lynch actually now because you see what an odd juxtaposition it is. It doesn't really suit the character. So it's like maybe Lynch just knew better. He was like, I don't think you want my voice for this. You want something much more sinister than what I'm doing. But what I would love to live in that alternate universe where we had, B movie with David Lynch and Gravity Falls with David Lynch. But
oh, it'd be beautiful.
In this universe, though, of weird things that we do have, apparently Sting played Victor Frankenstein.
What?
In a movie called The Bride with Jennifer Beals as the Bride of Frankenstein. What's this called? Clancy Brown was the monster.
Oh, and,
that's great. Phil Daniels, of course, from Quadrophenia, was back as a random bit part. The thing is, it's got really bad reviews, but reading about it, I'm like, this actually sounds like it would be pretty good. Like... It's like an alternate thing where, like, I think the townspeople burn down Frankenstein's castle as he's made the bride. So, like, everything sort of veers off from where it does in the movie. And then it's just, like, him teaching the bride how to be a person. And it's Jennifer Beals, of course, from Flashdance and et cetera, et cetera.
And what role is Phil Daniels playing?
I think he's just, like, random villager. Like, they had a name in it, but just it didn't strike me. I don't recall it as being a character from any version of Frankenstein.
He's not playing the monster.
No. I think it's Clancy Brown, of course, from like Highlander and Shawshank.
Pet Sematary 2.
Oh, is he in that?
Yeah. He's good in that.
I've never
Sting's
seen
in
that.
Pet Sematary 2.
No, Clancy Brown.
Oh, right.
Phil Daniels is in Pet Sematary 2.
Paul Daniels.
Paul Daniels is in A Cemetery.
T-O-O, of course, too.
Now, I just think of Clancy Brown from, he's in Carnival.
Yeah. The most drastic change between seasons where it's like, oh, he's a really complex, interesting character in the first season. And then season two, like, people don't get this, what this guy's supposed to be.
He's evil!
So just make him flat out evil. Like, there's no nuance to him whatsoever in that second go around.
I think it's because they were like, oh, we're getting cancelled. Oh, crap. Escalate this, quick, get to the end.
Yeah. But that's another thing. Another person who features in The Bride with Sting is a character actor called Christopher Fairbank, who is, of course, from Avidersen Pet. And I don't know if you guys remember, but way, way years ago, they made the first time they tried to make a Batman movie. there was this mugger guy, and he was like, "The bed, oh come on, give me a break, would you?" And all this stuff.
Yeah, don't
that's
remember that
guy. So, like, I think he obviously, you know, no one remembers those Batman films because they were terrible. Oh. But you know, that if you were so inclined, you know, I think they have some kind of weird cult status now. So maybe some people might be like, "Of course, that's Christopher Fairbanks from the first Batman movie." I think it was made in like, I don't know, 1972 or something like that. It was a long time ago. I can't remember the details about it. But yeah, of course, then I guess Sting went on a lot of different things. But he was, of course, the most famous part was playing the character of Zarm in Captain Planet and the Planeteers. So in terms of, like, you know, B-movies got a lot of environmental messages in it. Sting is no stranger to environmentalism.
This is one thorough IMDb trawl of the words of Sting.
Hey, we always bring the goods here on B-Minute.
So is the Captain Planet the cartoon?
Yeah, he is one of the voices in Captain Planet.
One of the voices. They didn't do a live-action one that passed me by.
The gritty live-action.
Oh, yeah, isn't it about time we had that?
Well, actually, now that you say it, yeah, that's
climate change. Oh my god, it's perfect timing. Come on, Captain Planet, gritty reboot, people.
I think like all the voices except like the main characters in Captain Planet, they're all like really like Jeff Goldblum's a voice in it. Like Whoopi Goldberg was Gaia. She was like one of the main characters.
Goldblum and Goldberg.
Yeah, friggin' Meg Ryan was one of the villains in it. And like, it's not one of these like, oh, the one, oh, I'll come in for an episode. It's like, no, they kept coming back time and time again. So I guess maybe they considered it like, it's kind of like community service. If I don't do anything really, but I just be a voice in a cartoon about environmentalism, then I can say, like, hey, look, I'm an advocate for the environment via appearing in this cartoon show about some who, like, I don't know, he constantly nearly dies every episode, and then they throw a bucket of water on him, and he's fine. not to poo-poo the great work of Captain Planet.
How dare you? How very dare you?
But yeah, so, like, there was a... That is Sting, or as... he's really known, Mr. Gordon M. Sumner.
Oh, I loved that, because when you research Sting as well, right, he hates being called his real name. Like, his friends don't use it, his family don't use it, his wife, you know, like, he won't even respond to it, he said. If you say that, he won't react to it, which makes this even funnier, because essentially, this bee is dissing him hard.
Mm. I'm going to confess something here. I thought I got a joke that they weren't making. And the only reason I thought it was this joke was because I'm ignorant. Because after they say Gordon M. Sumner, John Goodman turns around and I thought he says that's not his real name. And I thought that Gordon M. Sumner, because I don't know anything about these people, I thought Gordon M. Sumner, for some reason, that rang a bell as being Elton John's real name.
Oh, and so he's got a weird name. Joke.
Like Reginald D. Dwight or something like that. Reginald D. Dwight, I think, maybe is Elton John's thing.
That sounds right.
I think it might be Gordon Sumner, you know. It'd be an astonishing coincidence.
I love as well Barry's line here where he says, have you ever been stung, Mr. Sting? Because I'm feeling a little stung, Sting.
That's up there with Jerry Seinfeld's deliveries of like... I can't imagine he felt a lot of this writing was genuinely good. Like, he was just having fun saying stupid stuff like
that. Was there any writing? It sounds like Seinfeld's just being Seinfeld.
I mean, like, I know you, when we covered it on the show, John, like you said it was your favorite minute of the whole thing. But like when he comes into the graduation ceremony and they're playing Pomp and Circumstance and he says like, oh, there's a lot of pomp. Under the circumstances. Oh. And it was just like, it's such an eye-rolling joke.
I loved it as well because that's the theme song for the Macho Man Randy Savage.
He did have a lot of pomp about him. Mostly in his hair, that bandana plastering it down.
Macho madness.
There's a Larry David thing like that. So that's like, you always have pomp and circumstance combined. There's a Larry David thing from Curb Your Enthusiasm where he's like, muck. And Meyer. Oh. He never just did Muck. He always did Muck and Meyer.
That's true. That's an excellent point. I really wish Larry was in this film.
I can't imagine Larry like been able to actually like even pretend like he was taking any of it too seriously. Like, it's like Jerry Seinfeld, I can imagine, was like, I'm sure he was probably behind the scenes, was giving it a lot of stick, and Although, to be fair, though, he was out there promoting it like there was no tomorrow. And, like, as we mentioned, of course, back in our pilot episodes, I don't know if you guys have seen the trailers for B-Movie, but they're actual live-action trailers wherein they're trying to shoot B-Movie as a live-action thing. So it's Jerry Seinfeld in a giant bee suit. Like dangling from ropes and stuff and just been, like, really freaking out. And the director is Eddie Izzard, who's not in the finished film, weirdly enough. Oh, but he plays the director in these trailers. And then at one point, like, I think he's trying to, like, pollinate a flower. And then the whole set falls apart. And then Steven Spielberg appears out of nowhere. And he's just like, Jerry, just make it a cartoon. Mm-hmm. And then Jerry's like, oh, my God, Steven, you're right. And then it just turns into this.
I almost talked to Eddie Izzard a few months ago. And I should have just gone up to them. But I felt awkward. Like, because I was at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival. I was in the artist's pub. Like the backstage artist lounge, because I
get on you,
and we got in through friends, you know, and I went to the bar, got a pint with Ed Byrne, and then I went to sit down for a drink, and Eddie Izzard's opposite me, and I was like, oh, I really want to talk to Eddie Izzard, but it's like this is the backstage bit, the artist, like I don't want to be a dick. He's trying to chill out. He's trying to relax. I don't want to. So I didn't. In the end, I just stared awkwardly at them for a while.
I don't get starstruck often, or indeed ever really, with the one exception, which is that I, through my work, ran into Paul McCartney, Sir Paul McCartney.
Oh.
And I've through my work, I'm often in the same building as, but never really have to work with, alongside various celebrities. Yeah. But it's a job and you've just got stuff to do and you're too busy. So I never really get to, never really have time to get starstruck. But the way this worked out was that Paul McCartney's security walked through this venue space that I was in with Paul McCartney behind. And Paul McCartney's security went ahead of me and out a door to go and coordinate his vehicles. Mm. And so I just found myself in this venue space with just me and then Paul McCartney approaching me to have to get past me to go back to the thing. And I was just had a moment of, oh my God, it's Paul McCartney, which I wasn't expecting to have. And suddenly I'm going to have to say something to him. I've got to say something to him because it's just me and him in this space and he's going to have to walk past me. Just manners dictates I've got to acknowledge his presence somehow.
Yes.
Yeah. And I just kind of drew my breath, just kind of went, thank you so much for coming, and we'll see you again soon. And then he indicated to an empty platter of biscuits and went, oh, it's always typical, isn't it? I have one. And then I come back and the rest are all gone. And then there was a pause, full of internal brain panic for me. And then after a pause, I went, thank you so much for coming, and we'll see you again soon.
Aww.
And then there was another pause, and then he just walked off.
Hey.
You should have just let it be.
Oh!
Whoa.
Paul McCartney. Double pun.
Paul McCartney.
Oh. Oh, my God.
Why was he not in this?
What other celebrities could they bring in to B-Movie for this? Because the only one I could immediately think of to bring up in the stand would be Tony Todd from, like, Candyman. Because I guess Candyman would harm the reputation of bees. Because, like, oh, yeah, he's, like, guy stung to death by bees. He's got a chest full of bees and a hook hand and stuff. But then maybe that's too gruesome.
That's a fact about Candyman.
It's not a fact.
It may not be podcast friendly.
It's a fact. They should have got Bee Arthur. They should have got reggae artist Maccabee. They should have got... the Dandy and the Bee. No, I don't
know. These days you could get the actor Michael B. Jordan.
No?
Yeah.
Is it going to be the inevitable B-Movie sequel? Apparently Jerry Seinfeld's fighting it, but I imagine someday. Someday he'll cave. Once he needs another ivory back scratcher, he'll be on the show.
Well, we're all for it here at B-Minute.
Oh, of course so. Just before, though, we depart from Stink, because I was quite happy with it, because I came up with
because we brushed over Stink far too fast.
Oh, yes, yes.
No, just because as I was making my notes, I made up a joke. just because Stink was on screen. And so the joke is, what does Stink say when people huddle near him when he's at the urinal?
Every little thing you do is magic.
Hey. No. Nope. He says, don't stand so, don't stand so, don't stand so close to pee.
Oh,
hey!
Even better than I was expecting.
Good night, everybody.
B
Beam in it, everyone. Goodbye. We do then get a certain someone coming to the stand, another famous face to some people.
Mm.
Not so much to me, which you're going to find out in a moment, but it's Ray Liotta.
Yeah, it does. Ray Liotta's like a weird... The way they describe him in this film... Of course, it's all next minute, but like... Like Ray Liotta to most people is like, yeah, Henry Hill from Goodfellas. Like that's all he is, really. Like he's Henry Hill in Goodfellas, and then in the Hannibal movie, like Anthony Hopkins feeds him his own brain. Like that's the guy's legacy.
Do you want to know the only two films I've seen him in before Beaming?
Like
Beaming,
Smoking Aces, and I don't know. I was trying to reach for a movie, a random film, and it was like The Client. That's not even vaguely funny.
It's going to be... Like, I've not seen Goodfellas, people. I know the listeners probably know this by now, but...
Oh, it's just called Goodfellas, John. It's not called Goodfellas, people.
Goodfellas, people.
Yeah. That's Goodfellas Pizza was the tie-in to Goodfellas, but of course...
Jesus fucking Christ.
I have only seen him in Sin City 2.
No?
And Operation Dumbo Drop. Which is fantastic.
I think this must be some kind of insider joke because they tout him as being, we all know him from ER.
Yeah.
But he's got his Golden Globe with him. I think that must be some kind of reference or something to like, he didn't get an Oscar for any of the things that we know him from.
Yes.
But he ended up getting a Golden Globe for something that we don't know him from as much.
It's got to be.
So that's why he's brandishing the Golden Globe, even though he's in court.
Yeah. I just kind of took it as a joke of just like, he's such a petty egotist that he's like, he just carries around his Golden Globe everywhere. Like, wasn't South Park did that with Phil Collins. Like, they just constantly take, every time Phil Collins shows up, he always has his Oscars on him. And he's like, well, outrage, really, so I am.
I can say that we do all know him from gangster films, but this film, which is from what, 2007?
Yeah.
Everybody makes a big deal about famous gangster actors being de-aged using computer-generated technology in The Irishman, but B-movie was years ahead because if you look at what Ray Liotta looked like in 2007,
he did not look like that.
No, whatsoever.
This is like classic Ray.
This is like it looks like pre-Goodfellas Ray Liotta. It looks like about 22 indeed. Years old.
So you've not seen Goodfellas, have you, John? No,
never, never, never. I mean, it's only a couple of years ago I watched The Godfather.
Ah, Godfather's good. Yeah,
it's all right.
Yeah, it's all. I think I am a cinema basic bitch because when the chips are down, I would say probably my favorite actor is probably Al Pacino, which I'm surprising myself to say that, but those performances mixed in across all of those films, those famous gangster films, I think is some of the best stuff that you can see out there.
Mm. None of those guys, they didn't get all that acclaim for nothing. Like it's they genuinely earned it with the performances in those films. Like, but
it's the shouting. I think it's very, very, very hypnotic to listen to people shouting in those sort of. I'm going to say New York-y accents, but they're probably not. Are they? They're probably getting the completely wrong part of America. But
I'd guess the same.
Kind of anything like that. It seems Oscar worthy if you're shouting a very loud, swear a lot.
That's the great thing though within The Irishman. I'm surprised a lot of people I've seen online did not like that film. It's like, I really, really loved it. But it's just the fact because De Niro in it's playing like such a quiet, like really complex role. You can see like he's really, everything's registering on the inside. He's not showy. He's really trying to do like, he's internalized properly, really, really subtle, you know, understated performance and stuff. And he's great. And then Pacino shows up as Jimmy Hoffa and he's just being Al Pacino as Jimmy Hoffa. Yeah. Like he just shows up and he's like, oh, if you bought it, a truck brought it. And let me tell you, brother, you don't want to get anywhere without a truck. And it's just I love this.
That was brilliant.
I want 3 hours of just Pacino as Jimmy Hoffa.
Didn't even know there were any Chinese people in The Irishman. But then I was watching, I went through a phase of watching like behind the scenes, real life, how they came to have Goodfellas as a thing, both the making of, but then also the true life story behind it, because obviously there's a lot of nicely packaged, manageable YouTube videos you can watch about those things. I went through a phase of watching all of them. I mean, like, it's quite that everyone's got a cool story as to how they came to be in Goodfellas that they all tell in the behind the scenes things, because obviously Robert De Niro was brought up in, surrounded by a lot of people who were in the underworld, and Joe Pesci famously has the how funny how scene.
Oh, I know that scene.
Which is based on something that he'd seen from his childhood, and they managed to work it in.
That was inspired by the Animaniacs Goodfeathers sections, wasn't it?
That's, yeah, that came first. Where,
yeah, that's where he nicked all that from.
But Ray Liotta's story is, he auditioned for it and Scorsese didn't really want him for it, but then he was out and he saw Scorsese in a restaurant, and so he went over to Scorsese and went, you know, you really, really should really, really put me in the film, please, please. You should do that and put me in the film. I know you don't want to, but if you think about it, you should. And then Martin Scorsese went, all right, then you can. And that's his, like, behind-the-scenes anecdote for how he came to being Goodfellas.
I mean, it's got to be telling the fact that, like, Scorsese has since worked with everybody else involved with Goodfellas again, except Ray Liotta. Oh,
like,
he didn't get any part in The Irishman. It's like, oh, no, forget that guy.
Yeah. Well, he's too busy doing masterpieces like this.
Oh, yeah.
He also did, was he Grand Theft Auto Vice City?
Oh, he was now that Tommy is a Cassetti, masterpiece.
Wasn't he?
Yeah.
I do have to say, well, obviously we'll get into it a lot more in next minute, but I have already begun scouring the internet for a Ray Liotta Finest Honey t-shirt, just to see if you can get that on a shirt, because I feel I need that in my life.
Well, I had a question about the honey, right? So the joke is he's selling his own honey brand. Is this supposed to be like Newman's Own?
Yeah, I think that is.
I thought so.
Yeah, direct reference to that kind of thing.
Oh, I didn't get that. That makes sense.
But then at the same time, it's like, you know, it's a jab at Paul Newman for his salad dressings. But Newman's Own, by capitalist standards, is a great company. Like when they founded, Paul, I looked into this, he had two rules. He said, like, you have to abide by these rules or I'm not getting involved. Rule one, my face is going on every bottle, right? Which is fair enough. But rule two, all proceeds go to charity.
Oh, my.
Yeah, I think that's changed now. But despite that changing...
Just waiting for him to die.
They're waiting for him to die. But
despite the fireworks going up over the factory the day he dropped.
They do still donate a hell of a lot of money to charities. So... what's the gag? Like, I don't understand the joke.
The thing is, too, like, I can imagine they probably went through, like, I can't imagine their immediate thing was Ray Liotta honey. Like, I'm not sure what year Paul Newman died, but it could have been, like, they wanted to get Paul Newman in. Like, oh, Paul Newman honey. That'll be the joke.
They definitely wanted to get Paul Newman in just so Jerry Seinfeld, the B, could get cross with him and go, Newman.
Oh. Oh, there you go. Oh, that's clearly what it would have been. Oh, goddamn.
That would have been amazing. Oh, my God.
Oh, no. Now there's no way that's not what was happening. And then, oh, Jerry died 3 years ago. Like, oh, goddamn. It's like, all right, Ray Liotta. Like, and then, you know, apparently Ray Liotta came in for an audition, and then he saw Jerry Seinfeld out in a restaurant. And then he went over and he's like, could you please let me be in B-movie, please, 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 please. I know you really don't want to. And Jerry's like, all right, fine, you can be in the movie. And yet you'll notice that Ray Liotta has not featured on Curb Your Enthusiasm or any other Jerry Seinfeld adjacent projects.
Shameful.
Since his work on B-movie. But I do wonder if they have like a line of celebrities that they had, like, okay, we couldn't get... like David Warner, we couldn't get Michael Palin, we couldn't get friggin', you know, Mark Hamill. Ray Liotta, there you go, he said yes.
I think it's funnier that it's him, though, if he's known for his gangster roles.
I think every character in every CG kids film has a column of famous celebrities that they just go through for every single character. Okay, we can't get him, try him. 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 Until they get somebody who has 20 minutes in their diary to be able to go to a vocal booth somewhere and say whatever is written in front of them.
That's how you get me as a podcast guest. It's like, oh, 20 minutes on Friday? Yeah, okay, cool.
Well, that's the thing. I know they did... anyone listens to or watches the YouTube videos of Lindsay Ellis.
Oh, of course, big fan, yeah.
Yeah, she did a whole big thing about like the advent of big celebrity does animated movie, and it's all basically stemming from the inner workings of Disney and getting Robin Williams to be in Aladdin and stuff. And
oh, like, yes, and that was brilliant video, yeah.
Yeah, and just a whole big thing, because apparently he had done Ferngully previous to that, and he was very much into Ferngully, because Robin Williams was all about the environment and stuff, and then he went to do... There was something about the inner dynamics between the people working at Disney and rival companies, and then they're like, we got him in for Aladdin, and it was basically saying, he signed a contract saying, you will not overblow my character on the posters, you will not use me to promote the film, I will do the part, but you don't sell Aladdin on me being in it. And then Disney were just like, you know what, we'll just do it and then pay him off. And just whatever, if he wants to sue us, he can sue us. And then, yeah, that's all it was. The genie was everywhere in those goddamn posters, and they were really selling it the fact. And then ever since, it's been like, hey, they got Robin Williams to do that Aladdin movie. We can get in Ray Liotta to be in B-movie.
And it was perfect.
But look, I think I might be all buzzed out for this B minutes. I don't know, you guys have any other notes in addition to what we've talked about already?
No, I'm also buzzed out.
Yeah, I mean, usually at this time of the week, we always ask, two questions of the guests. Of course, our main one always is, you like jazz?
Yes.
Yeah.
Correct answer.
Yes, all right.
Yeah. And, of course, because obviously B-movies is, acclaimed classic. Everybody kind of grew up with it around our age and stuff, and they really, really beloved. I mean, we were all in our mid-20s when it came out, but... it was a big, big thing back in 2007. Do you guys have any personal history with this film at all? Or?
No.
I can't say that, dude.
No.
Oh, perfect. I think that's a clean cut there, John. I think we can...
That is absolutely perfect.
We can move on. I think we've pollinated this minute... for long enough.
Well, yes, we will buzz off into the lovely skies today. We will fly off back to our B-Minute Listeners Hive on Facebook. So do join us there. And, donate on Patreon as well, because it takes a lot of money to be in all this honey. So you've got to help us out there, people. And do join us again for the next minute, next week, of B Minute. We'll have minute 50 and new guests.
We may or may not have acclaimed character actor and notorious murderer Matthew Broderick, the star of B Movie, guesting. I'm not saying we definitely do, but we might have him.
It's possible.
Matthew Broderick to talk about Ray Liotta.
Just now, don't bring up the car thing.
Okay.
Let's also ignore the fact that the opening scenes of this movie are Matthew Broderick's character driving a car.
Basically. Yes. Well, cool, we covered that extensively back in the day.
Yeah, we won't say anything to him there.
If I were a bee, what kind of bee would I be? What kind of bee would I be? and I will take them all. We'll be right back.